This
one more note.
conference will now be recorded.
One more note, to make sure that we capture attendance, if you could please comment your name and who you work for, your affiliation in the comment section, we'd appreciate that. Okay, so I'm going to turn to our agenda for today's webinar. I'm going to begin by providing a brief overview of Great Lakes Commission's IWAM project, as well as a little bit of background as to why we're pursuing it. Next, you're going to hear presentations from, we have six presenters today, and those would be Susan Schell from Ohio EPA. Then we'll have Melissa Osborne, who's with the City of Windsor, and she's also the chair of the Canadian Network of Asset Managers, or CNAM. And then we're going to have several people giving a kind of a combined presentation about Michigan, and that's going to include Jessica Moy from the Michigan Infrastructure Council, Kelly Green from the Michigan Water Asset Management Council, and then Kelly Carl, who's and Ann Burns, who are with the Southeast Michigan Council of Governments, or SEMCOG. And then after they're all done, like I said, we'll open it up for Q&A and discussion. So for those who don't know, the Great Lakes Commission is an interstate compact agency that was established under state and U.S. federal law that's dedicated to promoting a strong economy, healthy environment, and high quality of life for our Great Lakes St. Lawrence region and its residents. The commission consists of governors, appointees, state legislatures, and agency officials from the eight Great Lakes member states. The provinces of Ontario and Quebec also have associate member status. In 2017, the Great Lakes Commission set out to investigate the state of water infrastructure in the Great Lakes Basin, and we concluded that there is a significant regional investment gap, and that gap is projected to grow each year if nothing changes. Our findings were summarized in our Joint Action Plan for Clean Water Infrastructure and Services, and that action plan also included a series of recommendations that were targeted at different levels of government to mitigate this gap. So I would invite everybody to go online and search for that and read the action plan. In brief, our top recommendation called for increased regional coordination for water infrastructure asset management, as well as the need to more comprehensively inventory and assess the current state of Great Lakes water infrastructure assets. That action plan was officially endorsed by the Great Lakes Commission in 2017, and we received funding from the Joyce Foundation, which has allowed us to pursue this IWAM project. So a little bit of overview of the IWAM project. We're in phase one of it, and it includes several components. The first is this webinar series, and today this is the fourth and final of the series, and all three of the previous ones are currently available on GLC's website if you want to link to a recording, and this webinar will also be uploaded there within the next couple days after we finish up. And there's also been talk of potentially in the future we might host more webinars since these have been going very well. The next thing that we're going to do is we're organizing some focus groups. And the purpose of these focus groups, it's more of a guided discussion really, where we're going to different communities and we're seeking information about best practices, barriers, and opportunities to learn, you know, what different professionals are doing to advance asset management and hopefully integrated water asset management goals, and what the Great Lakes Commission can do and how we can position ourselves to help communities achieve those goals. So we're in the planning stages for all of those that are going to take place between May and July. We're setting one up in Caledon, Ontario, and that's going to be sometime the week of June 24th. We're going to have one in Dayton, Ohio, and that's going to take place on June 28th. And we're talking with some folks in Erie, Pennsylvania, but we're less far along in scheduling that one. So if you are a water management or professional, or if you work on asset management or water infrastructure asset management, and you're anywhere near any of those three locations, please shoot me an email if you're interested in attending. We do have limited space, but we're still looking for people to join us. So get in touch with us if that's interesting to you. And then the final conclusion of phase one of this project is going to be a couple of reports. We're going to put out a phase one report that's going to summarize what we learned, including the barriers, opportunities, and best practices for IWAM. We're also going to attempt to draft some regionally shared goals for integrated water asset management. And then the final thing that we'll do is we're going to make a phase two proposal that will discuss how we plan to implement the phase one recommendations in pilot communities. So now that you have a little bit of overview of this project, I just want to address quickly, what do we mean by integrated? So first of all, we mean that locally across traditionally siloed sectors. That includes drinking water, wastewater, stormwater, green infrastructure. And it also could include things like transportation, communication, and energy. The second way that we mean it is regionally, across different geographies that could benefit from coordinating their asset management. And before we launch into our presentations, I'd like to just pull up this diagram, which we've been referring to in all the previous webinars. And this is the US EPA's five core questions for asset management. And previously, I've kind of circled which of these different five questions we're focusing on for the webinars. But today, we're really looking at all of them. And we're looking at how the states and provinces, they take all these ideas, and how do they integrate all of them to put an actual program into action and make it happen. And I guess one thing that I've learned or has definitely been confirmed through our research here and from speaking with so many thought leaders and professionals throughout this process is that there's no one-size-fits-all solution for asset management. Every community has different needs, and there's a different type of system that will service those needs. But there's a lot of good ideas out there, and they should be shared, which is why we're having this webinar. And there's a lot of opportunities to build on existing programs and to adapt other people's ideas to work for your own community. So with that, I'd like to launch into our presentations. And the first one that we're going to hear today comes from Susan Schell, who's with the Ohio EPA. And she's going to talk about asset management in Ohio. So we will now be passing control over to Susan.
And we ask for those of you who aren't presenting to please mute yourselves, just so we make sure we don't have any background noise.
Can you hear me okay?
Yep, we can hear you and see you.
Okay, great. Well, let's get started. Just kind of like go through a history of where we've been and where we're going in the state of asset management in Ohio. I'll give you a little bit of background on how we got to this point, some legislative information on how we made it official, talk a little bit about our roadmap to the future, and some funding things that we've done in our state to kind of promote asset management. So we got here by, it was really a series of some catastrophic events at some water systems in our state where either the recovery was slow or was complicated or things just didn't go the way we thought they should. I'm sure everyone's heard of, about the harmful algal bloom event in Toledo by now. That was a real eye-opener to us. Here we had a system serving over 500,000 people where suddenly no one could drink the water. And as a result of this, we had people on site, some of our staff on site at the treatment plant 24/7 for about 3 weeks trying to get things back up and running the way they should be. One of the real eye-openers for us was we found out that this is an old plant, really old, and it really hasn't been kept up the way it should have been. And when our staff was on site, we found out that something pretty critical broke down every single day, and that was normal for them. And we said, well, that shouldn't be normal. That's not good. And we had a similar situation in a little town down on the Ohio River, Gallipolis. They were out of water for a week. They had a major break that they couldn't find. They couldn't isolate it. They didn't know where the valves were. It didn't surface, so they had a heck of a time finding out where the water was going. But these are just a couple of the events that we had, and we were lucky enough to have the political will at the governor's level to really back us in terms of, you know, getting an asset management program up and running, because the governor said he wanted better responses from water systems, and he wanted it done now, which, you know, obviously that doesn't happen overnight, but we're getting there. So we said, well, we have this solution. We have this great solution. And we've been trying to do this for probably 10 years before that. But we just couldn't get the political will to, you know, follow through with the legislation and rules. But we finally had it. And what we've required is a documented asset management program for all public water systems. And it's basically just a business plan for water systems, running your water system like a business, you know, a profitable, resilient business. We wanted to make sure their capital improvement process is transparent and defensible to the customer, so they customers see where their money is going, what it's going for, and what they're going to get back in return for that cost. And it also identifies the true cost of producing drinking water, not just, you know, the day-to-day routine expenses, but really looking at the long-term expenses that are incurred by a water system and making sure that water systems reinvested in themselves and really put planning in place to be in a better position going forward so they wouldn't have these catastrophic events, hopefully, at least not as frequently as they had been prior. So we got a legislative bill passed. It was Senate Bill 2, and there's six key components for asset management. We want to make sure it includes an inventorying and evaluation of all the water system's assets. We want to make sure they have documented operation and maintenance programs. Emergency preparedness and contingency planning program. We already had some rules and along these lines, but we really wanted to make sure that they integrated well into their asset management program. We also wanted to make sure they were looking at criteria and timelines for their infrastructure rehab and replacement. So they were thinking ahead and looking at their approved capacity projections and capital improvement planning. And then finally, a long-term funding strategy to support the asset management program implementation. So once we got the statute in place, then we started working on our administrative code, which is kind of putting some meat on the bones of the statute. And we broke it down into three components: a managerial capability, technical capability, and financial capabilities. And these three components really kind of lay out the system's roadmap to the future for their system and puts all the planning pieces in place so they can actually implement their asset management program. Under managerial capability, some of the things that we're looking for, a clearly defined organizational structure. We want to know who's in charge of what and what their job duties are and the responsibilities of those positions. We also want to make sure that they have properly certified operators and that the required minimum staffing time is being performed. We want to make sure the owners understand that they have the responsibility and the ability to address violations. We also are looking for written procedures for things such as contracting and purchasing, security of the water system, use of system equipment, billing practices and revenue collection, and purchasing authorities. We want to make sure that everything is documented and everyone understands what's expected up front. One of the big things that we see as a problem in our state, and I imagine it's probably similar in other states, is succession planning. And we really wanted to call this out in the rules, so we wrote the rules such that the systems need to document that they're taking steps to ensure that they have critical personnel needed to properly operate the water system. Some key components of that succession plan should be identifying the key roles for succession or replacement, defining what sort of competencies are needed to undertake those roles, and looking at the people that they do have currently and against those criteria to see if they have the staff they need, or if they have some gaps that they're going to need to fill. And then if they've got some gaps, maybe identify some pools of talents that could potentially fill and perform in those key roles. And basically putting a plan in place to develop their existing employees to be ready for advancement into the key roles when the time comes. In terms of technical capability elements, some really basic stuff: treatment and distribution schematics with maps of the water source, treatment, storage and distribution system. We want to make sure they're getting an accurate look at their asset inventory, everything from the source all the way through to the customer, the meters, and everything in between. Condition assessment is really important. We want to make sure that they're really taking a objective look at the condition of each asset in their inventory and looking at what sort of shape everything is in, so that kind of gives them an idea of what the state of an asset is in regard to wear and tear it's received, and you know, that kind of leads to the next one is criticality and prioritization. So you look at the criticality of your of an individual asset, you want to look at things like some information such as a maintenance history. How likely is the asset to fail? How important is it to system functions? After they've looked at the criticality of the asset, then they can kind of prioritize based on criticality and condition in comparison to other assets to determine which assets are most in need of funding for future rehab and replacements, and put a plan together, a long-range plan, to keep that water system in good shape and replacing things when they need to be replaced, rehabbing things when they need to be replaced, doing the proactive maintenance, switching out of reactive and going towards more proactive, prolonging the life of their assets, and getting a little bit more bang for their buck in terms of their asset inventory. We're also looking at daily operation and maintenance programs, the procedures that the water system employees use to ensure that the water system is running the way it should, including things such as like the plant startup, normal water treatment system operation. Valve exercising is a huge one for us. We found that a lot of systems were not doing the valve exercising that they needed to do, and subsequently they would have huge outages because they couldn't really turn the valves to minimize the impact to their customers. So that's been a big emphasis for us. Also, make sure they have adequate flushing programs to, you know, keep the distribution system in as good a shape as possible, and making sure that they have maintenance schedules for all their components of the water system. And again, proactive maintenance is a heck of a lot cheaper than responding to emergencies. So we're trying to like change the culture of water systems to understand that and move out of the reactive emergency response type of thing to really, you know, thinking ahead and doing the things they need to do to keep things running the way they should. We do already have contingency plan requirements in our administrative code, so we just kind of incorporated that into our rule. One of the things that we do is making sure that the water systems hold exercises to practice their contingency plan. There's 10 circumstances that are included in our contingency plan. They have to exercise each and every one of those within a five-year period. So we're kind of keeping track of that and making sure that they are keeping up to speed, doing those exercises of the contingency plans, and afterwards kind of reevaluating how that went and making changes as they were necessary. Source water assessment, it's always been kind of voluntary in our state, so we kind of wanted to move more towards a more aggressive approach to source water. It is one of the most important assets, and you need to protect it. Without that, you're kind of out of luck and out of water. So we want to make sure that they're documenting the activities that they're taking and with their water system and their partners to minimize the risk of contaminating the source water through things such as source control strategy, information sharing, contingency planning, and water quality monitoring. We also look at capacity projections. We want to make sure that they don't get caught behind the eight ball. You know, you're looking at their demands and making sure that their system approved capacity is sufficient for the upcoming years, and that they've got plans in place when things start to grow or decline, depending on what is going to happen, and they've got adequate revenue to continue their operations. And this really means, you know, taking a look at adjusting the rates, looking for growth opportunities, and maybe establishing some connections with other systems to help meet demands in emergency situations. Also, this falls right along in line with the statutory requirements, making sure that they have a timeline for rehab and replacement of the infrastructure. They're going to need to consider the costs that are going to be necessary to keep that timeline online, and make sure they have they're raising the funds to be able to do the things that they need to do, and prioritize their most critical assets first, and then address any expansion of assets that may need to occur down the road. Also, we're looking at a 3 to 5 year capital improvement plan. We want to make sure that they have a description and estimated cost of significant projects for the next 5 to 20 years. So not just the 3 to 5, but looking even further down the road. So you can plan for those larger projects. But we do want them to look at their capital improvement plan every year and update it as necessary, and include the planning and detailed expenditures that they're going to need to do, decide how much money they should be saving and setting aside in a separate account for each year. The financial planning part of it, we want to make sure they have a long-term funding strategy to ensure they're sustainable and maintained properly. And it needs to be, the funding needs need to be identified, so they make sure they cover the financing of repairs, replacements, rehabs, and expansions, along with any repayment of any outstanding debt. We want to make sure that their system is covering their operation and maintenance costs, along with providing funds for a reserve account. So they've got a rainy day fund set aside in case unforeseen things happen. When we're looking at their financial capability, we're looking at their assets, their liability, their income, expenditures, and balances. Want to make sure they're looking at their current rate ordinances along with any periodic increases that they may need in the future. And we're asking that they review their water rates at least every 3 years to make sure that the revenue that is being generated is enough to cover the costs that they have currently and going forward. We're also making sure that the customers are all being billed for their water usage. We did put together some funding programs for asset management to try and get these up off the ground. We've kind of done a soft rollout of this over the first year. I will mention our everything went into effect October 1st of 2018. So we're still in the first year of the requirements for all of this. So we put together planning loans. They're 5% or 5-year loans at 0% interest. For this first year, we did put together a pretty nice pot of money for up to $10,000 in principal forgiveness for each one of these systems that had an asset management planning loan. So that's been really successful. A lot of systems have taken us up on that, and it was very popular. And that's what I had. So I guess we'll answer questions at the end.
Thanks a lot, Susan. That was great. And so our next presentation is going to be from Melissa Osborne, and she's going to be talking about the City of Windsor, Ontario's asset management program. And I think at the end, she's going to touch on her work with the Canadian Network of Asset Managers and give a larger national perspective on asset management. So we see Melissa.
Is the screen showing?
Yep, screen is showing, and we can hear you, so you're good to go.
Awesome. Thank you for inviting me today. I'm just going to quickly walk through the City of Windsor's experience over the last decade or so associated with asset management. Jenna, just going to go through, I call it figuring out the 1,000-piece puzzle without the picture. Where are we at, moving from innocence to excellence, our roadmap, the hard left turn that we went from should to must on asset management, finding the pennies under rocks, and the fact that nobody's alone in this. So in 2007, the Government of Canada put forward Public Sector Accounting Board requirements 3150, which I believe are equivalent to your GASB statements 34 and 51, which essentially said every single asset that a municipality owns needs to be reported on their financial statements and properly depreciated. Which, if any of you are like where we were, none of them had been really recorded or put in our financial statements anywhere. And in some cases, we actually didn't have record of them. So we had to figure out what we owned, where it was, what the condition is that it was in, and what it was worth. We also had to then figure out how we were going to put in some processes to continue to maintain that information, and what larger value other than reporting them on our financial statements and depreciating them could be obtained from it. And as we started looking at what that project was, all the pieces of the puzzle came from several departments throughout our organization. Engineering had part of the answers, operations knew another section, parks generally didn't really have a list of their assets, so we had to start with building an inventory of what they own that might be an asset. Facilities, going through identifying all the buildings we owned. Fleet was in a fairly decent shape. Our geomatics team was very helpful in providing a lot of information associated with our assets. finance, trying to figure out what the replacement cost value would be, and more importantly, how to determine some historical value just to first get it on the books. And legal, because in some cases we weren't necessarily sure what assets we owned, even though we might have had responsibilities for them. So it was a couple years endeavor to try and put all that together and figure out how do we get all of these groups to work together when they really hadn't before. And that was one of the big challenges. And so when you present something that is essentially a financial exercise to all those other groups, it's very challenging to try and bring them on board. So a lot of the work that we did was trying to figure out what information could we give them at the end of the day. And once we actually went live, we found that our engineering folks had actually started calling our finance folks to find out the replacement cost value of some of their assets, because even though they knew they owned the asset, they weren't quite sure what it would cost to replace it. And those were the questions they were getting from council. So we started to see some early wins in that. Quickly after we put that together, a corporate project was created, and that project was to define where are we at in our asset management practices by our different asset categories and organizationally. Because what became apparent was everybody did little pockets of it, but to what extent they did it and whether or not they did it the same way was radically different. So we wanted to benchmark where we were corporately and where should we be. Wanted to understand if we put a corporate asset planning division in place, what would be their role? And what would be the roles of the operational areas that actually deal with those assets on a day-to-day basis, and how do those work together? And then from understanding all of those, what's the roadmap to fill in the gaps between our operational and corporate practices? And then to provide an asset management framework and reporting structure that says going forward, this is how organizationally you're going to make sure that you all stay in sync and move together and really build a whole program that starts to take down the different silos and starts to connect them all together for better messaging and understanding of what our asset needs are. So in that process, the first thing they did is the Institute of Asset Management back in 2009 had 36 different elements of good asset management practice, and they were bundled under strategy, technology assets, physical assets, people, and business processes. And they graded you on an innocence to excellence scale depending on how you answered the questions that are on the left side of the screen of overall strategy and asset and customer service all the way through to asset management quality assurance. And they gave us a benchmark that said corporately this was pretty much where we landed on the scale of 0 to 5, but each and every individual asset category went through these same questions. So we could really zone in on who was a little bit more advanced in some of these things and which areas were perhaps a little bit behind and might need a little bit more attention and funding and help to get them to a better place, as well as what corporately should we all be moving towards if we're not well-defined in that direction either. The other requirement was that they had to identify what our department, the corporate department would be. So they created the asset management office underneath the CFO, reporting to our chief administrative officer. And the duties and responsibilities of the division became not only asset management, but also the capital budget and reserves, since that should be informed by good asset management practices, as well as corporate energy, which I'll talk to a little bit later because it was a wild card at first, but it actually became a very good link in the department. And then what we said is, even though functionally that's how they report, we needed to create an asset management network that the asset planning team would facilitate discussions between all of those managers in the operational areas to make sure whenever we're doing something corporately, they are fully engaged and they are providing their input on what that resulting corporate approach should be. The CMMS network is the folks that manage all the databases that existed. So we didn't want to put in place anything that might create some level of service requirements and KPIs to which the people that retain the data say, we don't even have this to answer that question. So they provided us that sort of level of information. And then as the senior manager, we have an asset planning steering committee that has been in place since the start and continues to be, that represents all the executive leadership from finance, legal, risk management, IT, operations, facilities, parks, our city planner, and our city engineer. And so that group ultimately confirms whether or not what direction we're heading corporately or what projects we're doing are correct, and they provide the support and communication to council as well. And then, as I said, it developed through that sort of information a roadmap of all the different projects that we should probably do to start moving ourselves from that innocence to excellence over the course of several years in order to build our asset management practice and fill in the gaps on any data or processes in the operational areas. So the division was created in March 2013. It was 18 months after the recommendations were approved. We, however, got a grant for $2 million that required that same year to have a council-approved asset management plan by the end of the year to secure the $2 million. So we pretty much dropped the roadmap and just focused on creating our first asset management plan, which really ended up being a high-level summary of our state of our current infrastructure. We had been doing some benchmarking stats against several assets across Ontario with other municipalities, so we pulled those in as some of our level of service and risk pieces. And we didn't provide council with any direction on how much funding we needed on those assets, just simply to say that we know our infrastructure gap is getting pretty high. We know that's not going to change, but we're not really in a good position to say what the funding level is because there's too many gaps in our information or too many guesses on our conditions to give a really good answer on that. And so what happened after that asset management plan is we rebooted the roadmap. And what we found is the asset management plan actually helped us confirm some of the information we thought was missing because the asset management plan was weak in some areas for data confidence or accuracy. It helped us cite those that were really strong so we could just let them continue on the way that they were. And what we probably needed to do between that report and the one that we are currently finishing right now so that it wasn't just an information, it was more of a set of recommendations on what it would take to fund our, what funding it would take to continue to sustain our assets at the current level of service they're in. And so in February 2014, we embarked upon several projects. We've developed a corporate level of service framework and template, and we've applied it for our roads and our sidewalks. We developed a risk assessment framework and tool, and we've applied that to our roads, sidewalks, facilities, and playgrounds. We developed a 20-year modeling through a tool, piece of software that we purchased that gave us different scenarios of what our road network would look like over the course of 20 years based on different funding levels, as well as whether or not we applied risk and level of service requirements on our roads. So if our expressway goes below a certain condition rating, we could program that tool to say it's never allowed to do that. Therefore, all funding must go to ensure that happens first and then allocate to everything else. We developed a life cycle costing tool, our life cycle costing report for our transit authority and provided those recommendations to council. We developed our asset management policy and framework strategy, which was also approved by council. And while those are all corporate approaches, we then really started working with departments. Our sewer network had about 20% of it with condition ratings through some CCTV programming. We worked with the department and started some Zoom technology. So as of right now, we're over 80% of the network with actual condition ratings, which makes our understanding of what's under the ground much better than what it was before. We've gone through assessments of our two pollution control plants, and we're starting on our pump stations, as well as tackling about 71 of our 150 or so facilities, but they're the biggest ones, to find out what the real condition is and what kind of funding is needed on an annual basis to maintain them going forward. And we've also implemented systems and processes for our park assets. What we found is those folks didn't tend to have any information or databases on their assets. The only thing they had was what was in our financial system, but communication of those changes was a little bit lacking. So we've really started to put some new processes in there for them, and they're pretty excited about that, actually. And along that journey, we hit what we would call a hard left turn from should to must. It started as a soft recommendation. So in Canada, we get annually federal gas tax funding, which for Windsor is about $13 million. And in 14, when the new agreement came out, it said, by the way, you have to have an asset management plan to continue to receive this funding. And it, that was about the extent of what they said, and we had already had our plan in place. So we moved forward knowing that that was there, but we were okay. We at least had that. In 2016, federal and provincial funding for both public transit and clean water wastewater funding came out, equated for Windsor to just above $20 million, but it required confirmation not only that you had an asset management plan, but that the projects you were selecting were in line with your asset management plan recommendations. And so that was the first time you really started to see that in a grant, you actually had to confirm not only you had the plan, but that your project makes sense for what you say your asset management plan should be. It was also the first grant I had seen that really focused on rehabilitation rather than new, which was also very nice. We've seen a lot of federal and provincial grants, all of them coming out requiring asset management plans and confirming that projects are submitted consistent with the plan. So it kept getting to be a stronger and stronger message. And then on December 2017, under the Infrastructure for Jobs and Prosperity Act, Ontario, and only Ontario at this point, approved Regulation 58817, which is an asset management planning for municipal infrastructure with very specific requirements. But by July 1st of this year, you have to have a policy and strategy, and it has to be approved by council. July 1st, 2021, your core assets, which are your roads, your water, your sewer, need to actually have a full asset management plan, including level of service metrics and funding levels required just to sustain the current levels of service that you are currently experiencing with them, not to improve them, but to make sure they don't degrade further. July 1st, 2023 takes that further to any and all assets that a city owns, and or any agency board or commission where our their financial statements are consolidated with the cities. So for us, that really expands it into several other organizations that we don't necessarily have direct control over, but now those statements need to happen. And then the 2024 requirement is that we have to say, this is no longer the funding that we need just to sustain them. The desired levels of service that we expect to see out of these assets is this, and in order to achieve that, our funding levels need to be this, and here is our plan on how to get there. And just to make sure that we're really going to do it, on April 1st of this year, our new federal provincial funding called the Investing in Canada Infrastructure Plan for Public Transit was released. The City of Windsor's portion is $144.8 million of federal, provincial, and our municipal contribution. And one of the requirements is that we must comply to Ontario Regulation 58817. Otherwise, any projects, even if previously approved, will no longer be funded. So they've really set the benchmark from it's a good idea to be doing this to thou shalt do this. And so as with anybody I have ever spoken to in Canada, the US, Australia, UK, South Africa about asset management, the biggest problem is where do you find all this money and how does it not just become another tax burden? What else is out there? So some of the things the City of Windsor has done is in 17, council directed that this division become responsible for all of the grants. And to date, we've put in $77.5 million in requests for grant funding between federal, provincial, and there's some private ones as well. And we've acquired $61.1 million of those being awarded, which funded 68 of our projects, allowing us not to have 100% municipal funding, but a portion of that. And the other thing is, and this is where that corporate energy group comes back in. So we went from just monitoring invoices to actually actioning projects that would either reduce our overall consumption or generate revenue. And two things happen from that. One, either those projects are generally funded from the savings and revenue, but when the savings and revenue have paid off the capital investment, we've requested council to redirect those savings or revenues to reserves and or funding of some of our infrastructure shortfall rather than just leaving it in the operating budget. We're recommending they transfer it to address the facility that the solar panel might be on or that the combined heat and power you might be attached to. Our pollution control plant is a great example of one where we've had well over $1 million in savings on an annual basis, and rather than asking for more funding to fund their reserve and maintain those assets, we've simply asked that the savings be redirected and become part of their reserves so that there's no increased cost from a municipal standpoint. And the last thing I just wanted to talk about, I know Dan mentioned that I'm part of the Canadian Network of Asset Managers, and I can say, having been working in asset management for a dozen years or so, you're not alone. Nobody's alone. Every time I talk to somebody new, I get a bit new information or another great idea that with a little bit of a tweak might work for us, or we share our information. Canadian Network of Asset Managers is exactly that. In 07, it started with seven municipalities across Canada saying, we all have the same problem. They became a nonprofit organization in 09 with a membership of 200. We've grown to over close to 500 in membership, 400 at our annual conference. We connect those folks at our conferences every year. It's a three-day intense workshops of different papers and discussions, as well as different webinars throughout the year, as well as newsletters and some forum work that we're doing to connect them in between. We receive federal funding, so Infrastructure Canada our federal government has put a lot of money forward on asset management. They've given some of it to the municipalities through programs to address your infrastructure. Some of the funding has gone to help you build capacity so that you can do your asset management plans. And some of it went to the Federation of Canadian Municipalities to allocate the funding to not-for-profit organizations that might be able to help develop good tools and techniques. And CNAM was awarded that funding twice now. Our first program resulted in an AM 101 booklet, webinars, and workshops to help people and councils, administration and councils who aren't sure what asset management is and why it would be important, to give them a look into and some ideas around that. And right now, our second round of funding, we're actually partnering with several other national organizations to bring a focus around a framework for what skill sets are required throughout the various disciplines to build a competency framework. So asset management isn't solely an engineering, an operations, a planning, a finance role. It really requires all of them, and environmental folks. And so that's what this project is all about. It's about bringing all those specialists that have an understanding of their skill sets and how that might feed into asset management to make sure it's a more holistic view of what's required. And that's pretty much my presentation in a nutshell.
Great. Thank you for that, Melissa. And so moving on, we're going to hear from our presenters from Michigan, and we're going to start off with Jessica Moy and Kelly Green, and then we'll move on to Kelly Carl and Ann Byrne. But now we'll pass control over to Jessica.
Okay, can you hear me?
We can hear you.
All right. Make sure I get the right screen this time.
Looks good.
All right.
Yep.
Well, first off, thank you, Dan, and the rest of your team at Great Lakes Commission. Appreciate you putting this webinar series on. I have to admit, it's a bit daunting and a little unfair to follow Melissa and all of the great work they're doing in Windsor and in Canada. I think our presentation is going to really demonstrate that, you know, Michigan is just sort of getting started in a lot of these areas in the early stages of the implementation, but also sort of set the stage for how we got here and where we're headed as well. So let's see. Okay, so you know, a lot of this early material, I'm sure, is of no surprise to anyone on this call and on this webinar. We're facing some really serious infrastructure challenges across Michigan, across all of our environments. Michigan has about 10 million people and services those 10 million people through over 3,300 different infrastructure owners. Now, when we talk about integrated infrastructure management in Michigan, we do include roads, bridges, so our transportation networks, as well as our water infrastructure, so drinking water, stormwater, and wastewater, our utilities, so gas and electric, and then also our telecommunications. We know that our infrastructure is not only complex, but it's also aging and in need of costly repairs and in a lot of cases, outright replacement. I know many of you are familiar with the ASCE, the American Society of Civil Engineers report cards, and Michigan is not doing great. Most of our grades are C's or D's with regard to where our water and our transportation infrastructure stands. So this really sort of set the stage for recognizing that we had some challenges and that those challenges really impacted every Michigander. We know that there's an importance in a relationship between infrastructure and infrastructure management, asset management, and public health and quality of life, certainly with regard to economic prosperity in our state. We have a lot of anecdotal information about loss of economic revenue because of our infrastructure insecurity, and that, you know, as all of you know in the Great Lakes region, the importance to our natural resources that we do have between all of us, right? One-fifth of the water, sorry, I have allergies as well. I know we talked about that a little earlier, and so my brain is not quite connected. I apologize. So anyway, the importance to that healthy environment as well. So as a result, under our former administration, starting in 2016, we really set forth in this state to start to look at that in a more holistic way. We started with the 21st Century Infrastructure Commission, which brought together a number of resources to look at cross-asset infrastructure in our state and the importance of that long-term vision across all of these different infrastructure types. That led to the need for an infrastructure asset management pilot. During the pilot process, we did a deep dive into the data side of the house, so an inventory of what kind of data we had with regard to our infrastructure across 16 different counties within the state of Michigan, and really looked at sort of two major population areas within the state, the west side and the southeast side of southeast Michigan, which encompassed about 50% of the state's population, both urban and rural communities, and really allowed us to look at not only the transportation and the water assets, but also the utilities and the communications within there as well. The outcome of that really demonstrated that we have the ability as a state to look at infrastructure asset management holistically, but what we hadn't really established yet is, should we do that, how we should do that, and sort of the structure around that process, which then led to some legislation. I know we talked about, you know, the legislation in Ohio and also the legislation in Canada earlier in this call and the need for that legislative foundation. In July of 2018, three public acts came into play in Michigan, the first being PA 323, which created the Infrastructure Council, the Michigan Infrastructure Council. That is sort of that higher level oversight over each of the different infrastructure components. PA 324, which created the Water Asset Management Council, and Kelly Green will be talking about that in just a few minutes. And then it also realigned through PA 325, the Transportation Asset Management Council under the MIC as well. And so our TAMC, or the Transportation Asset Management Council, had been in place for over 15 years here in the state of Michigan, but had never been part of a more comprehensive look at infrastructure management. So through this legislation now, we had more of a holistic look at integrated asset management across these different areas. So the MIC has really only been underway for about 8 months. We are comprised of a council that includes both state agency representation and also industry experts across local and regional governments, industry experts in each of the different infrastructure types, and then also expertise in policy and legislative and finance as well. Together, we've worked together in creating sort of the foundation for the council, putting forth our vision statement and our mission, and then more importantly, each of our five goals, so invest, educate, coordinate, prioritize, and collaborate, and a work plan around these five goals that will lead us to really that strategic vision for the state moving forward. And I think it's important to note that the purpose of the Michigan Infrastructure Council really is that strategic long-term vision for infrastructure asset management in the state, more so than you may know that in Michigan we're facing a number of infrastructure challenges today, both on the water and the transportation side. The council is really in place to look less at what's going on outside of our window right now and more about what's going to happen into the future for our state. So really that next 30 to 50 years out. So it's really heartening to hear all of these webinars and, you know, Susan's presentation hit on these same themes, Melissa's presentation hit on these same things, and the webinars even up until now that Great Lakes Commission has been putting forth. These similar themes around scope and definition, funding and financing, technology, and now implementation today, and that these, we really care a lot in our state about the alignment of each of these different pieces and then how they align with, in our case, our goals. So I thought it was interesting that the theme around scope and definition of asset management, which kicked off this webinar series, aligns so closely with our own goals around education, coordination, and collaboration. As a result, the council now is really focused on that common glossary of terms and definitions, in our case, across assets. So when we say something is in poor condition, that means something, right? So when you say a road is in poor condition, and then you say that a sewer line is in poor condition, that there is there's a common understanding of concern, a common understanding of what that means. Similarly, we're looking a lot at data standards and requirements. Again, Kelly will talk more about that with regard to the water side coming up, but looking at common standards around asset management plans and templates going forward. On the funding and financing piece, I know that others have hit on this through the webinar series. Our key goal is the word invest. Our governor recently said in her State of the State address that, you know, a state that doesn't invest in, no one will invest in a state that doesn't invest in itself. And so we feel really strongly around looking at investments overall with regard to infrastructure, the sources of those investments, where should those funds, sources that financing come from, alignment and timing. You know, when does that money come out, consistency, and really around then the sustainability. And then the third theme through the webinar was really the technology piece, which, again, we feel aligns with our goals of prioritize and coordination. We, and I know that someone mentioned this earlier in the discussion as well, really moving away from reactive to proactive management of our infrastructure, fully life cycle management, and that those metrics be measurable, that we can set targets and that we can move towards those goals in a holistic way. So again, we're really at the beginning stages of our plan in Michigan. We have a 3-year work plan that will lead us to that 30-year integrated asset management strategy. We are at the tail end of our year one. We've released our 180-day strategy up on our website. I encourage everyone to take a look. And then we'll be moving toward then that 30-year plan in the next couple of years. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Kelly to really sort of do a deeper dive into the Water Asset Management Council.
Thanks, Jessica. So I'm coming at this from the angle that I work with the Water Asset Management Council, but I am also an employee of the state in the Department of, well, the Department of what was the environmental quality, and we'll get to that in a couple of slides down the way. So I'm going to talk a little bit about what the Asset Management Council is doing and working on, and also what we've been doing in Michigan from a regulatory standpoint with asset management. So as Jessica has mentioned, out of the asset management pilot project, the legislation was created to develop the Water Asset Management Council, which is housed under the MIC, the Michigan Infrastructure Council, and it's the idea was to house it in a similar fashion as the Transportation Asset Management Council, which Jessica mentioned has already existed for over 15 years. The administrative staff and technical staff to the council are provided by the Michigan's Department of Environmental Quality. So the overarching goals of WAMC are to advise the MIC on a statewide asset management strategy related to water, to develop standard asset management templates for water infrastructure while also working in collaboration with the Transportation Asset Management Council and their templates. Also tasked with reporting on an annual water infrastructure asset condition and investment needs. So what are the investment needs around the state, and what is the water infrastructure? What is the actual condition of the water infrastructure around the state? And lastly, the council is tasked with identifying statewide training needs to help promote an integrated asset management structure across the state. So here we have the pilot project was born from Governor Snyder's administration, and in 2018, the Michigan elected a new governor. Her focus continues to be on protecting public and environmental health in an integrated way, and just last week, the Department of Environmental Quality transitioned to the new Department of Environment, Great Lakes, and Energy. The newly formed councils continue to press forward, and everybody recognizes that asset management is not political, but an important tool for creating sustainable infrastructure. So if you'll hear me reference EGLE, that's the Department of Environment, Great Lakes, and Energy, which is a mouthful, and we're still getting used to saying that around here, you can imagine. So a little bit of history about asset management in Michigan. And while the councils are new, EGLE has been promoting the use of asset management for nearly a decade. And I like everyone's approach that asset management is moving from a reactive to a proactive approach in dealing with infrastructure. And the DEQ really looked at this as a way to try and remove regulations that lead to consent orders. So if a community was managing their infrastructure under an asset management program, we were hoping to help alleviate some of those consent orders that we have in place in the state. So on the wastewater side, in the wastewater programs, the department has been adding asset management conditions to major NPDES permits, so the National Pollution Discharge Elimination permits, since 2013. And that reaches about 90 facilities. This started at about the same time as our SAW grant program. If you've heard of that, this is the Stormwater Asset Management and Wastewater Grant Program, which is a program that funds the development of asset management plans for wastewater and also stormwater management plans. As you can imagine, this was a very successful program. It's actually still underway, and the state allocated $450 million of state funding. And on day one, when the applications were coming in, we had over $500 million worth of applications in just one day. So it was a very, very popular program. In fact, I believe in the Senate's most recent proposed budget bill, they have an additional $30 million written in for continuing that SAW program into the future. So continuing with the wastewater asset management, the department is also looking at adding and just began to add asset management requirements into the NPDES permit holders for minor permit holders. So they're starting with the permit holders that have greater than half MGD dischargers. And this brings about another more 30 facilities into the asset management requirement. The department is also looking at adding asset management components to a new collection system general permit, which is under development. So we have a lot of collection systems in the state of Michigan that do not have NPDES permits, so they're combined with another system. So they don't technically have an asset management requirement through the state of Michigan yet. On the stormwater side, all of our MS4 stormwater permits contain some asset management-like components. And the idea is that the department will integrate additional asset management requirements in future years. But as you know, funding is a big challenge across all of the assets, but especially with the stormwater. With drinking water, all of our community systems that serve a population of greater than 1,000 people were required to have an asset management plan in place as of January 1st of 2018. So now getting back a little bit to the WAMC legislation. So the legislation that put WAMC in place actually defines specific requirements as it relates to an asset management template. And the idea here is to create either one template or multiple templates, which the council is currently working towards, for the different asset classes. And this is really a means to submit the data into the Water Asset Management Council, so then we can take that data and report it back up to the Michigan Infrastructure Council. And one of the key items here to note is that the WAMC legislation actually does not allow for WAMC requirements to be any more strict than what DEQ is already requiring. What EGLE is already requiring. And if you have an asset management requirement through EGLE, you will have an asset management requirement through the Water Asset Management Council. So here's a list of the asset management plan components that are required for a community to complete. Asset inventory, the level of service analysis, the risk of failure analysis, anticipated revenues and expenses, performance outcomes analysis, the description of plans to coordinate any work, and proof of acceptance by governing body. So these are almost identical to what's required on the transportation side and the Transportation Asset Management Council, and these are also nearly identical to what the what EGLE is already requiring in their asset management programs. You'll note the last one, proof of acceptance by the governing body. We did feel that that was an important component to include, as this means that your governing body, your council, has reviewed your asset management plan, has signed off on it, and those are the folks that are going to be related to adjusting your rate structure if needed. Just real quick, some of the challenges that we're encountering, Jessica mentioned, are around defining terms and definitions so that we're all speaking the same language. Right now, the Transportation Asset Management Council, which has been in place, uses a different rating scale than is typically used on the water side. So there's a bit of a challenge in making sure that we're all speaking the same language there and we're comparing apples to apples. It's also often a little bit challenging when you get a large group of folks in the room who are very smart, very highly educated, to agree on what the definition of level of service should be or how should we get to prioritizing our assets. So I'm sure that others out there are running into those same issues too as we move forward with asset management. So as we mentioned, the Transportation Asset Management Council has been in existence for over 15 years. My personal opinion is that when they first started, they were looking more at inventory and condition of assets. And it's also a little bit easier, as you can imagine, on the transportation side, the majority of their assets are above ground. They're easily able to identify the condition of those assets. And there's also in Michigan funding tied to those asset management programs and developing the asset management programs, which prior to the SA program in Michigan, there was no funding in the state for water asset management programs. So in summary, the three councils, as Jessica mentioned earlier too, the Michigan Infrastructure Council is our quote unquote parent council, if you will. But we're really all working together to create a culture of asset management across all the assets and really lean towards an integrated asset management approach for future needs across the state of Michigan. And that's all I have.
Great, thanks guys. And now we're going to hand it over to Kelly and Rachel at SEMCOG.
Hi, good afternoon. This is Kelly Carl. Can you hear me okay?
Yep. We can hear you.
Great.
And we can see your slides.
Great. Thanks, Ned. And thank you everyone for the opportunity to share information about the development of our regional program. As we're working with the state, based on what Jessica and Kelly just talked about, I just wanted to kind of reflect back on Melissa's presentation also. There's a few key things she said that I think directly relate to some of the program we're developing. Is one is others are in the same canoe, and maybe we think about that as we look at road right-of-ways with different infrastructure types within the same area. We also look at this as leveraging processes that are already in place, and that's something that I'll be talking about as part of this presentation. And I think a key thing that's kind of transcend all the presentations is that this is really going to provide a larger value, more than just looking at complying with a new regulatory requirements, as we look at improving our overall infrastructure coordination. So I think what I'd like to talk about today is, you know, I'm going to provide really a perspective on how the regions are uniquely suited to help compile and synthesize and report out on some high-level metrics, such as investment needs and infrastructure condition. I'm also going to provide a quick overview about transportation planning processes at the regional level and how that can support improvements in overall infrastructure project and funding coordination. But first, let me give you a quick introduction to who SEMCOG is for those of you that might be less familiar. Our region's highlighted here on the map. SEMCOG is a local government membership organization that includes about 180 units of local government, community colleges, and intermediate school districts in Southeast Michigan. SEMCOG supports coordinated local planning with technical data and intergovernmental resources to our membership and other partner agencies in the region. We are the regional municipal planning organization and the designated water quality management agency for Southeast Michigan. We've been actively involved with water resource planning since the 1970s. And we recently completed the 2045 Regional Transportation Plan. We also manage the 5-year Transportation Improvement Program. We provide technical assistance on economic development, bike and ped planning, parks and rec, and regional population and demographic forecasting. So we're located along the Great Lakes Corridor, and our region includes 7 counties, along with the larger cities of Detroit, Ann Arbor, and Port Huron. We border the Lake Huron to Lake Erie corridor, which also includes the connecting waterways of St. Clair River, Lake St. Clair, and the Detroit River. Our region has about a population of 4.7 million, covering about 4,600 square miles. So I'm going to get right into talking about the program. Jessica and Kelly described the high-level goals of the Michigan Infrastructure Council, the Water Asset Management Council, and the Transportation Asset Management Council. The regional program that we're currently developing is really intended to be one wheel with this and within this entire system, as you can see here. SEMCOG's regional plans listed here, you know, and actions really guide our work within our member communities and partner agencies and also at the legislative level. Our recently adopted 2045 Regional Transportation Plan and Water Resources Plan both highlight overarching asset management policies that you see here. In order to move forward with this regional program, we've also formed an asset management team comprised of staff from local infrastructure agencies. Our member communities and partner agencies on this are really the practitioners and the experts in managing infrastructure, their own infrastructure, whether roads, water infrastructure, or private utilities. We've also secured a consulting team that includes Hubble, Roth & Clark and OHM advisors to work with us and our local agencies to develop this regional asset management framework. So our team has outlined four main goals shown here: understand condition and needs, facilitate performance improvements, compile and communicate investment needs, and increase collaboration and coordination. All of this must be accomplished through a collaborative process that can effectively integrate priorities across multiple infrastructure types and agencies. This is not just complying with a new mandate, but we're establishing a framework that's really going to help facilitate strategic investment in infrastructure across multiple infrastructure types. Finally, if we reflect on the goals of the MIC and WAMSI and our program, you can see on this graphic here the alignment of the common goals. So in the diagram, you can see the five priority goals of the MIC at the top: prioritize, invest, educate, collaborate, and coordinate. Likewise, the WAMSI goals for an asset management template are listed at the bottom. It's easy to see what information is needed to collectively work towards the statewide goals. The SEMCOG goals I just described are shown in the middle, and we are now just beginning to refine the details of what data is actually needed to work towards all of these goals. So let me talk a little bit about transportation. So our Regional Transportation Plan, or RTP, is a long-term blueprint of the region's transportation system. Usually RTPs are conducted every 4 years and maintain a 20-year horizon into the future. SEMCOG recently adopted the 2045 RTP for Southeast Michigan in March. The plan identifies and analyzes transportation needs of the region and creates a framework for project priorities. It also describes how more than $35 billion in revenues will be invested in 174 projects to support the region's transportation system through 2045. A Transportation Improvement Program, or TIP, also known as the Short Range Plan, lists all the transportation projects in the region that seek federal transportation funding within a 4-year horizon. The TIP implements the policies of the RTP. The current TIP represents about $4.4 billion in transportation investments. So the next graphic shows the overall planning process. This is the transportation planning process to develop the RTP. Don't worry about trying to read all the details there. Just recognize that there is an existing process in place that results in the selection of transportation projects for federal aid funding. There are a number of factors on the left side that are considered. Existing condition of roads is a factor, along with regional and national trends, such as an aging demographic, future technology, and funding shortfalls. We also seek to align this plan with related elements of other regional plans that are listed there. Components of this process are also utilized when reviewing the Transportation Improvement Program, which is the short-term transportation plan. For example, environmental factors are considered on a project basis. This process can be used as a framework to integrate other infrastructure types and see where projects may or may not be aligned in similar geographic areas. The important takeaways related to this slide are this. One, there is a process to analyze and summarize transportation infrastructure condition. Two, there's infrastructure condition is one of many factors for project selection. Also, the Transportation Improvement Program identifies projects 3 to 5 years in the future, allowing for flexibility with changing budgets and other factors. And finally, if we can begin to align other local capital improvement programs that are often 3 to 5 years in the future similarly within this framework, we are confident that we will work towards improving overall infrastructure coordination in the region, leading to significant cost efficiencies and overall improvements. So as I highlighted on the previous slide, existing conditions of roads is one factor in the selection of transportation projects. SEMCOG, MDOT, and the county road agencies collectively identify the condition of all the county roads on an annual basis in the region using what is called PASER evaluation. PASER stands for Pavement Surface Evaluation and Rating System. This data is a factor for transportation planning process and also with our local federal aid committees as they select projects. The data allows us to identify the makeup of our federal aid eligible road system, such as type of pavement, number of lanes, and the condition of these roads. Through other data requirements of TAMSI, such as project type, timing, and budget, we have the makings of a plan to strengthen coordination across multiple infrastructure sectors. For SEMCOG, we use this information to estimate the cost of addressing our regional road system by running several scenarios using a mix of budgets and different fixes. SEMCOG's, just to give you an example, SEMCOG's homepage shown here contains a map and data showing the most recent PASER or condition ratings for roads in our region. Based on the compiled condition ratings, we can project that road funding in Southeast Michigan needs to increase from $400 million per year to $1.6 billion per year for 25 years in order to improve roads to 80% good or fair condition. You see all the red lines on there? These type of statistics on condition and investment needs are critical to working towards improving our infrastructure. Likewise, the value of having similar information for water infrastructure and private utilities can not only raise the level of awareness for public and the legislators, but strengthen our ability to secure funding for our infrastructure needs. The bottom line is that we are not starting from scratch to create a more coordinated asset management program. The elements of an overall framework are in place at the regional level, and we can work collaboratively with our team and other partner agencies to integrate water infrastructure components into the process. As I mentioned, the 2045 Regional Transportation Plan identified $35 billion in revenues for transportation infrastructure through 2045. I wanted to reflect back on an old report that was related to water infrastructure. In 2001, SEMCOG completed the first ever sewer infrastructure needs report. And to this day, the media still calls and quotes on this report. The principal finding in this 2001 report was that approximately $15 to $25 billion was needed by 2030 to maintain and improve sewer infrastructure. When accounting for inflation, interest, and borrowing costs, this estimate rose to almost $50 billion. When we can update this type of information for drinking water, wastewater, and stormwater infrastructure across the seven counties, combined with the transportation investment needs, then we will be better positioned to leverage funding from multiple sources and align our projects from a construction standpoint for greater cost efficiencies. One of the most important elements we see of developing this collaborative asset management program is education. As a regional membership organization, we have many existing avenues for not only garnering support for this asset management program, but to also offer education and training about asset management. From large-scale workshops to one-on-one meetings with local agencies, we have a multifaceted approach to work with our members and other agency partners. Creating a culture of asset management across all infrastructure agencies will be a long-term achievement, but we will be successful through our collaborative efforts. And finally, we have an entire technical team of people working on the development of a GIS framework to support this program. This includes a very experienced technical staff at SEMCOG, along with our consulting team of OHM and HRC. I'm going to turn it over to Ann Burns, SEMCOG's Manager of Geospatial Technology, to talk through some of what we're working on right now.
Okay, thanks, Kelly. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah.
Hello? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so I'll get a little deeper into our data collection efforts. We're using ArcGIS Hub for this project, and ArcGIS Hub is a web-based platform for collaboration and engagement. This technology will allow us to bring our communities into the story at the regional level. We will work with the system owners who want to contribute their data so that we can provide an assessment of our infrastructure to the state of Michigan. ArcGIS Hub is an ESRI product, and it's primarily used to manage data-driven initiatives and share related information. It allows us to gather and analyze data in a collaborative manner at the regional level. The back end of ArcGIS Hub is ArcGIS Online, which is already part of our GIS infrastructure. We're currently working through the details of the workflow to allow those who want to participate in the project to upload their data. We'll provide an ArcGIS Hub account to those who want to participate. This account will provide access to any report or dashboards created from the data. SEMCOG will provide an empty file geo database containing our data schema. And for those who don't want to convert their data to our schema, we'll provide them a field matching tool. This is the concept of our field matching tool. The tool will allow you to identify the fields in your database that match the fields in our database. As a pilot project, we used a similar tool in ArcGIS Pro that worked well for us.
And then I thought I could just show you an example of an ArcGIS Hub page that's out there. Let's see. Yeah, this one. Okay, so New Zealand is currently using ArcGIS Hub to reduce plastic waste in our oceans. And this example shows you how you can use the dashboard functionality to provide statistics and information about the data you collect. So there's a good example of an interactive map that's dynamic as you zoom around. It can give you the statistics of the data that you've collected. So this is something that we probably wouldn't go public with, but we could provide this information to the data contributors or an aggregate version of the data. And that is all I have.
Okay, well, thank you very much, guys. Those were all really great presentations. And we're going to open it up now for questions. So we're going to switch control back over to me real quick. And I think to start it off, we will open it up to the entire audience, but Ned was going to lead it off with a question for our presenters.
Yeah, thanks, Dan. So I'd be interested to hear from each of you. These were really great presentations. And thinking about kind of now that each jurisdiction that we talked about and these different levels have asset management programs in place. One of the things we're thinking about is different ways that communities and states and provinces and regions are looking at trying to measure success for asset management. And I guess maybe if we could go around to each of our speakers, starting with Susan and going through the order that you guys presented, if you could share different ways that you guys are thinking about measuring success for your programs or monitoring and trying to define success.
Okay, this is Susan. One of the things we built into our asset management program was some metrics, some standardized metrics for like standard set for communities and a standard set for non-communities. And we're going to be asking the water systems to report those to us on an annual basis so we can kind of see some trends. And for example, for community systems, we're looking at things like waterline break history, cost per connection served, emergency versus routine maintenance on vertical assets, water loss rate, that sort of thing. So we're hoping to be able to see some trends and see some improvement through those metrics as we get some data and over a span of a couple years. And of course, there's always the, you know, hopefully we'll see an increase in compliance and lesser a lot fewer emergencies or large emergencies that we need to respond to. So that's kind of some of the things we're thinking about at this point in time.
Thanks, Susan. Melissa?
I guess from our end, there's a couple of different ways that we're looking at success. First, internally, are we having success that organizationally we're starting to understand and appreciate the practices, and are we all coming together to start to say the same messaging corporately and to our council? And we've seen a lot of progression in that particular area. Our division is very actively involved with the operational areas, and the messaging that we're starting to hear from our executives to our council and mayor seem to be the same messages that we've recommended as, you know, long-term sustainable funding, looking at dealing with what we already own, not exclusive of what you need to grow in, but certainly putting a focus on it to make sure that we have something in place to deal with what's already there. And so that messaging has proven to be successful. And on the other side of it, what we're also trying to make sure we do is that we, you know, they've always said asset management or building new sewers isn't necessarily a sexy thing. So how do you get the engagement from your councils and from your residents to buy into what this is in a very real practical way that's not technical, that they can understand it, that they can appreciate it, and they can approve it because at the end of the day, it might be not sexy to fix a pipe, but when your basement is flooding, then you know that pipe isn't working. So we're trying to create that relationship. And I think when we go to council this summer, it'll probably be our first indicator of whether or not we've gotten some success out of communicating the messaging of long-term sustainable funding, of putting in place those practices that our councils and our community can adopt to let us balance out the problems and stop them from getting worse.
Okay, thanks, Melissa. And the Michigan folks?
Sure. So this is Jessica. So I'll just say from, again, a high level perspective, we do have performance metrics as part of our legislation. And so early on in this process, our legislature recognized the need to be tracking and monitoring and setting goals around metrics and performance. From a high level perspective, we're really looking at that asset management maturity. So that full life cycle around asset management and, you know, as it relates to all the different facets, right? So not just data and inventory and condition, but also around people and governance and long-term sustainability. And maybe, Kelly, you could speak more specifically to then now particular type of infrastructure.
Sure. So, at least from the department's perspective, one of the things that we're looking at monitoring success or something that we've seen is we've seen a lot of communities that have implemented their asset management programs actually look at their rates and increase their rates. So we're not thinking that just increasing rates is an end-all be-all, but we know that the discussions that are being held and those decision makers are understanding the need of looking at your infrastructure, looking at it holistically, looking at creating sustainable funding sources for the infrastructure. And like Ohio, one of the other items we're looking at is bringing those systems that are out of compliance back into compliance. So we're seeing some of that with the use of asset management. And with the SAW program, we did do a survey probably a year and a half ago with the SAW program. And one of the interesting things we noted about that program was a lot of communities said they're now looking at criticality, and they're not just replacing assets because they're old, but they're looking at including that criticality into their plan moving forward.
Great. Thanks, guys. And Kelly Kay, you know, I know you did mention performance metrics earlier in your presentation, but maybe you could reiterate.
Well, you know, just to kind of add on to what Jessica and Kelly said, I think from a regional perspective, when we think we have about 180 members and other agencies, we really want to be being able to communicate investment needs in the region for infrastructure, overall condition, and obviously seeing an increase in, you know, adopting asset management practices across all of our communities within our region. But also looking at, as we improve infrastructure coordination for projects, you know, from starting from the planning phase, you know, what are those cost savings that we're realizing by, you know, re-looking at, and I'm trying to align a number of our different projects.
Great.
Thank you.
Thanks. And so we are at the top of the hour, so I'm just going to wrap up with a couple slides. First off, I want to thank all of our presenters from today and from this entire webinar series. I've learned a lot, and I hope everybody else has. So some next steps and opportunities. If anybody listening in right now has more they want to say and they weren't able to chime in, please drop us a line. We'd love to talk with you about your thoughts on this webinar and all of our past topics. I mentioned before, we're organizing focus groups in Caledon, Ontario, in Dayton, Ohio, and more preliminarily, but we're looking into having one in Erie, Pennsylvania. So if you're a wastewater, drinking water, or stormwater, or green infrastructure, city planner, if that's your business and you would like to attend one of these focus groups, well, we're going to try to learn how we can build a program at Great Lakes Commission that best supports integrated water asset management goals. Drop us a line, and we'll see if we can work that out. If there's any other literature you think that we should be reviewing to get good ideas, let us know. And just in general, other leaders in this space who have not been a part of this webinar series, let us know. We'd love to talk with you. And finally, as I mentioned earlier, phase two of the IWAM project will be implementing our recommendations and conclusions from phase one. So if there are any communities that are right now looking to increase their asset management goals or maybe start for the first time, and they might be in a position where the Great Lakes Commission could potentially provide some support, let us know. And we'd love to just speak with you guys and see how we might be able to collaborate. And so that's all that we have. Thanks again. This has been a really great webinar series, and look out for the next steps of this project.
Thank you, and have a good day.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.